Hello students, welcome to second PUC political science online class. As everyone knows, because of coronavirus pandemic, as students are having to stay at home, online teaching have become common today. So today we are here. Dear students, in your online classes you have already learned two chapters under political science syllabus. Today in this video let us start with the chapter number 3, that is administrative machinery in India. Now first of all I would like to give you an overview of the topics which are coming under in this chapter. The important topics under this chapter are administration, meaning and role, civil service, meaning and features, all India services, central services and state services, central, state and district administration, UPSC and KPSC, composition and functions. Now at first I would like to address the topic, the meaning and role of administration. Before that, let me quote the definition given by E. A. Negro on administration, that is, the real core of administration is the basic service which is performed for the public. E. A. Negro, he said administration as the real core of administration is the basic service which is performed for the public. It means that the administration ensures the security and protection of life and property of the people in the society by maintaining proper law and order. Let me continue by giving some information on administration. Dear students, a government cannot function or cannot exist without administration. Administration concerned with the performance of the activities by the government in the public interest. Modern government go a long way in formulating and adapting the rules and laws and regulations. It should not be forgotten that such policies and laws are not merely printed papers. Such paper declarations of intent are translated into reality, and thus public administration converting word into action and forms into substance. Now this public administration is a major force in bringing stability in the political system. The present day government is expected to do various functions to its population which require highly specialized professional and technical services. Moreover, the emergence of welfare and democratic state has led to an increase in the activities of the public administration compared to that of laissez-faire state. Now the laissez-faire state means simply it performs the activities of protection of the individuals. But nowadays modern government, it performs various activities for the welfare of the people. The state has to now serve all sections of people in the society. This enhanced the responsibility of public administration today. Now let us get to know the meaning of administration. Now in the meaning of administration, the word administration, the English word administration, is derived from the Latin words, two words, ad and ministrare. It is derived from Latin words. Those Latin words are ad and ministrare. Here ad means public and ministrare means to serve. Ad means public, ministrare means to serve. In this way, the real task of administration is to run the government and look after the people. Now, let us discuss the definitions of administration. Definitions of administration. We can understand what is administration by going through the various definitions given by the political scientist. According to J.M. Pfaffner, administration is the organization and direction of the men and material resources to achieve desired ends. Administration is the organization and direction of men and material to material resources to achieve the desired ends. As J.M. Pfaffner said, administration is the organization and direction of the men and material resources to achieve desired ends. Now, what is the meaning of this definition? It means administration consists of getting the work of government done by coordinating the efforts of people so that they can work together to accomplish their set task. Now, one more definition given by H. Simon. He defined administration as, administration means the activities of groups. Administration is the activities of groups. Groups cooperating to accomplish common goals. Cooperating to accomplish common goals. This is the definition of administration given by H. Simon. Now, what is the meaning of this definition? It means administration is the activities of the executive branches of national, state and local governments, and also of government corporations and the certain agencies of specialized character. Now, continuing with the same, that is the concept of administration, I would like to elaborate the topic. Dear students, the concept of administration is as old as ancient civilization. It can be traced back to the ancient times. It is, for example, during monarchy, the administration was used to execute the efficient and effective functioning of the government with a view to provide the services to the people, with a view to fulfill the demands of the people and solve their problems. So, it can be traced back to the origin of the concept administration. It can be traced back to the Vedic period. And if we go through the development of the history of development of administration, we can find two unique features. The first feature is that the administration, under administration, the village as the primary unit of administration and decentralization as its goal. Now, this kind of administration, we can find the glimpses of this kind of administration during the Vedic period, during the Vedic literature, Jaina literature, in Mahabharata, in Ramayana, then in Manusmriti, Shukraneeti, Arthashastra and others. The second important or unique feature of in the history of development of Indian administration is the contemporary Indian administrative system, which is characterized by heterogeneity of ideals, goals, structures and roles. So there are two unique features in the history of development of Indian administrative system. One is village as a primary unit of administration and decentralization as its goal. And the second feature, second unique feature of in the history of development of Indian administration, that is the contemporary Indian administrative system. And also with the emergence of nation state concept, the importance of administration has increased further. Now what is this nation state concept? Nation state concept is a concept of large politically sovereign country which may or may not be dominated by a sense of common ethnicity. So with the emergence of this nation state concept, the importance of administration has increased. Now coming back to the same point, with the emergence of the concept of nation state, the importance of administration has increased, and also with the emergence of one more concept called welfare state concept, the importance of public administration has increased considerably. Now what is this welfare state concept? Welfare state concept is a system of government in which the state enhances, the state ensures the socio-economic well-being of the citizens, and it is based on the principle of equality of opportunity and equal distribution of wealth and public responsibility for those who are unable to avail themselves of the minimal provisions of a good life. So with the emergence of different concepts like nation state concept and the concept of welfare state, the administration, importance of administration has changed considerably. Now with the introduction of system of welfare state, the scope of administration gradually increased, and that took place industrial revolution, scientific progress, technological advancement, etc. Dear students, in this way the growth of administration took place in India. So in the beginning the administration is very simple. We called it as a laissez-faire state, simply to provide basic facilities to the people and providing them the protection is the activities performed by the laissez-faire state. But today in the modern period, the states are called welfare state, welfare states, and they perform various activities, and in this way the importance of administration has increased considerably. Now I will focus on the topic, next topic, role of administrative machinery in India. As Charles A. Beard said, administration is the science of modern civilization. Charles A. Beard, he said, administration is the science of modern civilization. So Charles A. Beard, he said regarding the role of administration as administration is the science of modern civilization. It means that we cannot think a system without a system of administration. It may be in the private institution or in the public, a system of administration is required to run that institution properly. Now, one more definition given by Gerald Gaydon regarding the role of administration. Gerald Gaydon, in 1971, he listed the following features to point out the role of administration in India. Let me explain you the important points given by Gerald Gaydon regarding the role of administration. That is, according to Gerald Gaydon, following are the important features which point out the role of administration. The first point, preservation of polity. So, what is the role of administration means? It preserves the polity. Now, what is polity? Polity means a system of political activities. The administration protects the polity of a state. The polity, that is the system of political activities, for the preservation of these political activities or smooth functioning of political activities of the state, the administration is very important. Now, the second important point is maintenance of stability and order. Maintenance of stability and order. Now, the next important role of administration is maintenance of stable political system. Even when there is change in the governmental leadership, the continuity and stability in the political system should be required. There should not be instability while there is change in the governmental leadership. So, it is the administration which ensures stability or continuity in the political system even when there is change in the political leadership. In this way, administration play an important role in maintaining stable political system. So, administration is very important in respect of maintenance of stable political system. The third point, institutionalization of socio-economic changes. Institutionalization of socio-economic changes. Now, for the progress of any society, there should be socio-economic changes in the society. Now, this administration, it brings socio-economic changes in the society. To bring socio-economic changes, it requires an organization, and this organization functions smoothly only by the proper administrative system. For a socio-economic changes, an organization is required, and for this organization to be functioning successfully or smoothly, the administration is required. So, administration, its role, we can say, in the institutionalization of socio-economic changes. The fourth point, management of large scale commercial activities. Management of large scale commercial activities. Dear students, in modern times, it is not possible for any public enterprise to manage large scale commercial activities. In this situation, most of the big or large scale commercial activities are carried by the government through the proper administrative system. We can give example for this. For example, the public sector undertakings. Therefore, for managing large scale commercial activities, the administration is very, or public administration is very important. Now, fifth point, ensuring the growth of economic development. Ensuring the growth of economic development. The role of administration is very important also in ensuring growth of economic development. Now, how the administration ensures the growth of economic development in any society means by establishing industries, encouraging agriculture, commerce, so on, administration play important role in encouraging or in ensuring the growth of economic development in any society. Next point, protection of weaker section of the society. Protection of weaker section of society. Now, who are called the weaker section of the society? There are a certain section of society, for example, the women, children, handicapped, the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe people, they are called weaker section of the society. For the protection of the interest of the weaker sections of the society, the administration plays very important role because it is the public administration which can only provide basic facilities to these weaker sections of society according to the provisions of the constitution. Now, next important point, formation of public opinion. Seventh point, formation of public opinion. It is the administration which places before the public the policies of the government. Seeing these policies, the public can express their opinion on the policies of the government. In this way, the role of administration is very important in the formulation of public opinion. The government, it makes the policies, and the administration, it places before the public these policies on which the public expresses their opinion. In this way, the administration, it helpful in the formation of public opinion. And the last point, influencing public policies and political trends. Influencing public policies and political trends. By providing proper data or information, the administration helps the government to run the day-to-day political activities. In this way, the administration plays important role in influencing the public policies. To run the government requires certain data or information which is provided by the administration. By providing proper information, the administration helps the government to run the day-to-day public activities. Dear students, in this way, the role of administration is very important. To this, I have completed the first part of the chapter. I would now like to move to the next part, that is civil service. The next topic, civil service. we will understand the meaning of civil service. Before that, let me explain the background of civil service in India. In India, the term civil service used by East India Company to signify the administrative service in the state. To select the personnel for the higher post, the British rulers decided to hold a competitive examination, and the Britishers called this as civil service to differentiate it from military service. So, in India, the civil service is used first by the East India Company to signify the administrative services of the state, and they called it as a civil service to differentiate it from the military service. Now, let us turn to the meaning of civil service. Now, what is the meaning of civil service? The term civil service refers to the permanent executive. Civil service means permanent executive. Why it is called permanent executive? Because there exist two types of executive. One is political executive, another one is permanent executive. The political executive is an elected body, and permanent executive is a selected body. Political executive comprises from the President of India to the member of Gram Panchayat, and permanent executive includes the cabinet secretary, from the cabinet secretary in the topper level to the peon at the bottom level. And in other words, political executive means those who directly elected by the voters, and permanent executive means those who selected on the basis of their merit through the competitive examinations conducted by the Public Service Commission. We can give example to this as civil service. So, there are two kinds of executives, political executive and permanent executive. One more thing, the permanent executive, it works under the guidance of political executive. For example, a department under the government which functions under the guidance of the political executive, that is the minister. But without the assistance of permanent executive, the political executive cannot function. Therefore, under administration, these both executives works, the political executive and the permanent executive. The permanent executive work under the guidance of political executive, but for the works to be done, or for the smooth functioning of the government, the political executive must be assisted by the permanent executive. Without permanent executive, political executive cannot function. Now, let us understand the various definitions of civil service. According to R.G. Gettle, R.G. Gettle, R.G. Gettle, he has given a definition of civil service as, civil service is general body of official serving under heads of various departments and known collectively as the civil service. known collectively as civil service. So this is the definition given by R. G. Gettle regarding civil service. So he said, R. G. Gettle, he said, civil service is general body of official serving under heads of various departments and known collectively as the civil service. It means that under the government there may exist departments, various departments, and each department work under the leadership of a special body of officials, and this special body of officials is called or are called civil service. So under government there may exist various departments, and each department work under the leadership of a minister in charge of a ministry, and this minister, he is assisted by a body of officials, and this body of officials called officials are called civil service. So this is the definition given by R. G. Gettle on or regarding civil service. One more definition given by E. A. Gladden, he has given definition on civil service as, civil service is a regulated administrative system. Civil service is a regulated administrative system organized as a service of interrelated officers. So this is the definition given by E. A. Gladden. He said, civil service is a regulated administrative system organized as a service of interrelated officers. That means, civil service is a group of people who work as a team. So they always work as a team according to the rules and regulations of the Constitution. So civil service is a system, they work as a team according to the rules and regulations of the Constitution. Everything is in a systematic manner. So this is the meaning of civil service or definition of civil service given by E. A. Gladden. I hope you have understood the definitions of civil service. Next, I will move on to the next topic, that is the features of civil service. Under features of civil service, the first important point is professional body. Now, civil service, it is called a professional body of officials who are permanent, paid and skilled. Now, these officials, they are called permanent because they enjoy their term till their retirement age, and they are paid. The salaries and allowances of civil servants are fixed and they are skilled. The officials selected for the top post in the civil service, they are deputed to in-service training. Therefore, they are skilled because they are given in-service training to acquire knowledge of administration. Hence, one of the important feature of civil service, as Herman Feiner defined, it is a professional body of officials who are permanent, paid and skilled. So these are officials, the civil servants, they are permanent officers and they are paid and they are skilled officers. This is the first important feature of civil service. The second important feature, that is hierarchy. So the officers under civil service, they are arranged in the hierarchical manner. That is, under this system of civil service, the officials are placed in accordance with the scalar system. Under this scalar system, each civil servant has to obey his immediate superior officer, a high ranking administrative officer with a discretionary power supervises his subordinate. So it is the officials under civil service, they are placed in a scalar system. Under the scalar system, each officer is answerable to his next immediate superior officer. And a officer with high ranking, he supervises his next immediate subordinate. So in this system of hierarchy, authority, it runs from the above. Authority runs from the above, which makes the administration stable. Now one more important feature, that is political neutrality. Civil servants are required to be politically neutral so that they can serve faithfully. They refrain from political activities. They serve sincerely under any government in power, no matter the controlling authority. So the permanent executive called civil service, they should be politically neutral. They should not involve in any political activities. They should not give any political statements, or they should not give any, or should not indulge in any political activities. By this, they can serve the public sincerely, faithfully, and they can serve sincerely under any government in power. If it is the authority, it changes from one government to another, no matter, they can serve faithfully or sincerely. And next point, anonymity. Still another important feature of civil service is the anonymity. The civil servants work behind the screen. Anonymity means working behind the screen, and they remain anonymous. Means they neither disclose nor speak to the public on governmental matters except they are authorized by the minister supervising the ministry. So they never speak in the public. They neither expose or speak to public regarding the governmental matters except they are authorized by the ministers in charge of a ministry. Now the recognition for good work or disrepute for any omission, it goes only to the minister and not to the civil servants. The civil servants, they give administration, but recognition for good administration or omission, any kind of omission, the credit of it directly goes to the minister but not to the civil servant. That means they cannot held responsible for their official actions. The ministers are politically accountable for the success or failure of their ministry. So this is called anonymity, one of the important feature of civil service. Next important feature, that is impartiality. This feature of civil service says how the civil servants work. The civil servants should discharge their duties, official duties, without showing any favor, bias or preference to any section of society. They must serve all the people without religious, class, gender, ethnic or any other sectional bias. So they should work completely in impartial manner. They should not work in favor of any section of the society. For them, all people are equal. They should show equality in performing their duties. So in this way, the civil servants should work impartially. So impartiality is one of the important feature of civil service. Next important feature, that is service motto. It means the civil servants work for the welfare of whole society and not for the welfare of particular section of the society. They must be humble and service minded towards the public and not authoritative. Next important feature of civil service is permanent. As all of you know, civil service is called permanent executive. The civil servants, they enjoy security of tenure. They enjoy their term till their retirement age. The retirement age of civil service is 60 years. Remember, the retirement age of civil service in India is 60 years of age. The civil service, they remain intact while government changes periodically. Government may change from one leadership to another, but the civil service, it remain intact. Next important feature, jurisdiction of law. Now, every civil servant has to function within the prescribed jurisdiction of law. There is prescribed jurisdiction of law according to the rules and regulations of the constitution, and the civil servant has to perform his duty within this prescribed jurisdiction of law. If he crosses his limit, then he will be met with the disciplinary action. So this is the important feature of civil service. There is jurisdiction of law, that is the civil servant has to perform their duties within the prescribed jurisdiction of law. Then last point, special training. Special training. Once the candidates are selected for civil service, they are deputed to in-service training to acquire special skill in administration. So, for example, Lal Bahadur Shastri Academy of Administration, located in Missouri, for the training of newly appointed IAS officer. In Missouri, there is Lal Bahadur Shastri Academy of Administration. It is meant for the training of newly selected IAS officer. Likewise, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel Police Academy, located in Hyderabad, which trains newly selected IPS officer. In this way, the officials appointed to civil service, they are given in-service training to acquire special knowledge or special skill in administration. Dear students, these are the important features of civil service. So, this particular topic, the features of civil service, you can expect questions for 5 marks, very important question, that is explain the features of civil service.